As a filmmaker, there are moments when I search for something more than the tangible. For the stories buried beneath both earth and time. Remembrances of generations past, now dust. In this journey, I'm struck by the fact that what seems in the moment to be random and unconnected events in the end are all joined by a single thread of serendipity woven through the fabric of time. And I wonder if the connection I feel to these events is also fated. Like players on a grand stage, are the spirits like masked actors playing out their roles, or are they breaking from the scene and trying to communicate with us directly? I wanted to see if I kept each of the investigators separate, if their findings would reveal cooperating evidence. So I took the investigative groups independently through each location, not sharing any evidence or information until after they'd drawn their own conclusions. As I share these stories, these ghost stories with you, I continue to question, are these scenes we've captured through the camera's eye evidence? Evidence that we're not alone.
Every time you get to hear as well.
Really?
It doesn't feel good.
I'm not sure about the last bit. That almost sounds like a growl, doesn't it? You hear that?
There's a long tunnel near Tunnelton.
She's more of a male, but the loss is like the child. There's a child.
A child?
Crying. And sobbing.
A little girl was playing in the tunnel when she was surprised by a train.
Say that again.
She wants her mum. So you're picking up a child?
Yeah. She wants her mum.
She tried to crawl off the track, but didn't make it.
Please help me. Please
help me. How old is a child, do you think?
She's not old. I don't know, maybe 6, maybe 7. That sort of age. They're quite young.
There are those in the area who say they have seen her spirit playing at the entrance to the tunnel.
She doesn't know where she is. Something else as well, something not nice, I don't know what it is.
The founder of our museum was Julia Meek Garr. In 1930, she founded this museum, and she was a world traveler. We know she was overseas at least 7 times prior to 1929, which is very early for traveling. And she went to Egypt and ended up buying a mummy.
Our basic procedure is to go into an area we believe may be actively haunted.
Writing down some notes for our investigation so that way we can go back when we do our evidence review and compare it to the notes that we have to see if there's any significant correlation. We always take notes in every location that we go to.
Well, I come in a lot of times late at night to do the floors or early in the morning. I hear some noises that represents nothing that you heard before.
And to begin our session with basically a time, date, stamp, location where we're at, and ask a series of questions regarding who they might be, where they're from, maybe how they died, a little bit about their lives.
What a lot of people don't realize is the Egyptian culture mummified people for 4,000 years. See, ours would date, post-date to Tutankhamun. Approximately 3,000 years old. It's the late 21st dynasty.
I'm getting something that's connected with the priesthood.
It took her 5 months to get through the red tape to allow that mummy to be released from the from Egypt.
Here we are in a museum and we're looking at some ancient Egyptian artifacts and mummies and so forth. And one of my theories is that ghosts understand us on different wavelengths, not just what is verbally spoken, but on thoughts that may be projected.
Okay. And that it was found in the 1880s. Back when they discovered all the royal tombs.
Okay.
And that was the same time that they found the Rosetta Stone.
In many hauntings, the questions are pertinent to some of the things that have happened in the past, if we know any of the history about the individuals, or if we know anything about what's been happening with the hauntings.
Man, I'm trying to get back to the original way it was found.
Well, she was told by the shop owner that it was, at that time, a priestess.
The first image I got, I got a female.
But now we're realizing it is a male.
Then I got totally confused. I started picking up on a male energy.
A lot of that has been interpreted. We have signage around the mummy for interpreting the writings.
But the last researcher that we've had work on this, she says that the mummy is a fitting to the coffin.
It's mostly dealing with the gods that they believed in.
I hear a very, did you hear it? I hear something.
The lid of our coffin has a wonderful prayer on the front of it.
There's something about the death.
Usually the name of the person that was mummified was put at the footboard of the coffin lid.
That's why I see just a skull. Or I see something, I kept getting something about, just the bones.
And ours is blank. Where the name normally would go, ours is blank.
The one thing I do feel, like I see green, I see something green and purple, almost like amethyst, and I see like more like an amulet, like a protective piece of, what is definitely like a ceremonial piece of jewelry.
Back in the late Victorian period of time, that some tourists just bought mummies to bring home as a souvenir. And of course, a lot of times they were not treated right and they were unwrapped at get together.
Whatever this thing he had was very strong, very important to him that he wore.
The one thing I've noticed with the people in the mummy area is particularly the school children will not go into the room. And it's not like they can see the mummy. They have to make the decision to go into the room before they actually can see the mummy, and they won't go in the room. It's probably a 30 to 35 year old male.
The mummy process was to dry the body out. It took 70 days to do that.
One of my theories is that ghosts understand us on different wavelengths. We can talk about psychics and how sometimes they pick up on random thought patterns and feelings. Whether it's emotions or whether it's some sort of a visual of something that's happened. It's easy enough, I think, for us to try and use thought patterns, in this case, to hopefully get EVP as far as the Egyptian artifacts go.
From hundreds of miles away, Marilyn sensed an energy surrounding the group and connected with us via cell phone.
I am going to consciously and on different levels link in with you while you're there. There's an energy that's running diagonal through that space. You need to kind of go to whatever the southwest area of where the mummy is, and there's a vortex of energy right there.
There were slight fluctuations in the southwest corner.
It started swinging probably, I don't know, 20 degrees, and it's not doing it now.
Have proof in themselves, it'd be interesting that they cross. Mm-hmm. At the same location that we had the compass spin in, that kind of a weird reading with the air ion counter.
Because sometimes it'll do that.
Maybe, it's still doing it.
Obviously, whatever is there is not going to bridge the language barrier with us verbally, but if we can send, project our thoughts, perhaps then we'll get some sort of a message back.
Even after several thousand years, the smell of decay was heavy in the air.
What was your most prized possession?
I feel like something happened to me. I think I hit in the head. I feel like there was some scuffling.
When I came into this room, as soon as I crossed the threshold, right. It was right here on the side of my head. And that's one of the reasons why I was asking if anybody knew how this particular mummy died.
There was some scuffling before his death.
Both intuitives had the sensation of pain, pointing to a potential cause of death for this mummified soul.
Anything else? Thank you.
As the session ended, the group was eager to analyze the evidence and spent some time on site reviewing their recordings for EVP.
Okay. It almost sounded like somebody said okay when we were in the Egyptian exhibit there, and I was setting up the EVP.
Questions, and perhaps we'll get an answer.
You hear it there?
And perhaps.
Yeah.
Perhaps.
What's really interesting about this is, now this is my gut on this. A lot of EVPs are not really hard to hear, but that's almost like it's got this big, huge power to it. You know what I'm saying? Does it feel like it's bigger? Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes it can be like that. I mean, sometimes they're louder and sometimes they're quieter. I mean...
But it's almost... It's just got more presence to it or something.
Right.
Without being louder. You know what I'm saying? I can't...
And perhaps...
Like it feels the authority.
Perhaps...
Like it's, telling us to come in, maybe.
Yeah.
And perhaps...
So...
Yeah, things that go bump.
I just kind of figure that it's our place during the daylight hours, and then at night it's their place.
That's right. Hey, that's a good way to look at it.
Anywhere I go, no matter where it is, no matter how old it is, I'm going to see orbs, things like that. Sometimes a full figure spirit walking by.
Did you see that?
The only thing that bothers me is if I walk in a place and I'm automatically feeling uneasy, I could feel the bad energy around, and if there's something negative there, then that's what jumps out at me.
Michael started, I can't remember how old he was, and he would ask, "Mom, who's upstairs whispering?" And that's when I knew he might have the gifts.
Normally, human spirits are like small flames, the glow from a matchstick in a dark room. But Michael Jones, the boy who reportedly inspired the movie The Sixth Sense, seems to be a bonfire that attracts other wayward spirits to him, both good and evil.
So you saw an apparition when you first came in?
The one thing that bothers me with seeing ghosts is I'm not afraid to see spirits or anything like that. It doesn't bother me because I've seen it my whole life and I'm used to it.
I tried to have Michael have a normal life.
The one thing that does bother me is when they jump out at you, or if you're not expecting it, you turn around and it's right there in your face, and it gets pretty scary.
He had gifts, and you can't exercise a gift, you can't tell it to go away, it's there. He's gonna have it for the rest of his life. And that was the issue we had.
It's when I feel like I'm upsetting an entity that might be here, I try to apologize and make peace, and you know. And I have had some issues up on the third floor, and I was very interested in what you might pick up there.
I was younger, I was in school, and I didn't want anybody to know about it because a few people knew, and I was called Ghost Boy, and people would just say that I'm crazy. You know, parents wouldn't let their kids hang out with me unless they wore a cross on their neck. I mean,
Michael, he would go into a paralyzed state, and this would happen. And he would be in this state for like 6 hours. And if I put anything holy on him, he would be choked. You actually see his throat going in, and he'd be gasping for air. I started recording these things, him into these states for the doctors. Like, they have to see this.
Michael was drawn to the third floor, to a room seldom used.
I could have swore that when I was moving, the eyes would start to follow me, and then they'd go back, looking straight ahead.
There's different things that scare different people. Sometimes just the atmosphere, when you go into a home where the demonic are, the evil, just total evil being present, that just permeates your body. It just, I don't know how to explain it really. It's just a feeling that you get internally. It's just really, you can't shake it.
Did you see that?
What?
I could have.
What?
You get down and you move. It's almost like it's trying to.
I seen it when you were moving. I seen it from right here.
It's like it's trying to avoid me noticing it. You know what I mean? I could have swore that when I was moving. Eyes would start to follow me, and then they'd go back, looking straight ahead. But the thing of it is, even if it is an illusion, by the way, the pain and everything, that's where I felt when I first came in here. Something was here. When I first came in, I was concentrating on this, but that's not it.
They're definitely moving somewhat because one was looking this way and one was looking kind of straight. And I've been noticing that the eyes weren't even, but now it looks like they're both looking towards you.
Yeah. Isn't that weird?
Both eyes are over here. Before, one was looking over here. I swear to God, one was looking this way.
Yeah, I'm getting the chair. That's fine.
Thank you.
there's a lot of people that just don't understand it and are scared of it, and I wanted to wait until I was old enough and I was out of school to, you know, I'm comfortable with everybody knowing about it.
Graphing in a cemetery one day, and I've seen pictures of Margaret, and thought, well, heck, if you're here, you must be bored. Why don't you come back to the house with me? I invited her back that night. She was in our kitchen. I've seen some orbs following me around about knee high through the bedroom. Wifty, wifty things watching us and then disappear. The orb I saw was fluorescent green.
When I was young, I would see orbs and I would see things like that, and I assumed that everyone saw it. I didn't think anything of it until I was laying in bed one morning and I saw an orb floating above me, and it kind of, usually they were always small, they were, you know, they would kind of flash and just go away, but this one stayed there, and it kind of just changed shape into the shape of an angel. And I went downstairs and I told my mom, I was like, Mom, I just saw an angel. And she was like, what do you mean you saw an angel? I was like, well, I saw the little balls of light that I always see, but it kind of changed its shape into an angel. Not everyone sees that. Oh, we went outside and we were picking up a lot of orbs in the pictures. I kind of felt something following us around. And I was looking in the shed, and I definitely feel a lot in the shed. I'd like to go in there.
Spirits can inhabit inanimate objects as a place of refuge or as a staging point for an assault on the living at a later time.
There's a ton of orbs in this that I didn't even notice. I just get a real eerie feeling from it, which, I don't know, tells me that there's definitely something bad connected with it. It could be one of two things. It could either be something like something traumatizing happened around that item, something bad could have happened, and I could be picking up negative energy from that, or it could be a negative spirit that's, you know, attached to the chair. If I just see orbs or whatever, I don't really acknowledge it. I'm only looking for something negative. But something about that chair, I don't like it at all. I don't feel anything specific. I just get a real eerie feeling from it, which, I don't know, it tells me that there's definitely something bad connected with it.
So, like, when you've had those feelings in the past, then it's been something.
It could be one of two things. It could either be something that, like, something traumatizing happened around that item. Something bad could have happened. I could be picking up negative energy from that, yeah. Or it could be a negative spirit that's, you know, attached to the chair.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, sometimes it's hard to tell the difference.
Eerily, the autofocus eventually chose its own mark. An unnatural face lurking in the shadows. Yet another mask, like the doll inside the house. Yet another feeling of another worldly presence lurking behind those eyes.
It's so hard to explain, because, like, if you were going to tell someone how it feels to be happy, if you were going to tell them what in your body makes you feel happy, it's just unexplainable. Yeah. So you just know you feel it. And when I was younger, I always felt it, and I had no idea, you know, I didn't understand a lot of it.
He's had one girl, I think she said she was killed in the bathtub, but, you know, she just wouldn't cross over, she was afraid, you know, things like that. He tries not to talk to them. When they start talking to him, yeah, Michael just started, he lost his fear when he was about 17.
I want to give everyone the benefit of the doubt, even if it seems like what they're saying isn't true. I don't want to automatically say I don't believe them or I think they're lying, because you really never know. You know, the spirits, if it's negative, can, they always can play games with you, you know, hide when people come, just so people don't believe them. And that same sort of stuff has happened to us before, so I try not to, you know, just push anyone away and say, I don't believe you. If they need help, even if I don't believe them, I'm gonna do whatever possible to help them.
There's different things that scare different people. Sometimes just the atmosphere, when you go into a home where the demonic are, the evil, just total evil being present, that just permeates your body. It just, I don't know how to explain it really. It's just a feeling that you get internally. And you know, sometimes I think that's worse than things you visually or hear. It's the feeling, because it sticks with you and it kind of just takes part of you.
I just have a feeling that when it's past 2 a.m., that's their time. Mm-hmm. And that might be a refuge for someone.
If the spirit's kind of lingering around, it's going to want to be recognized. It's going to want you to notice that it's there, so it'll move things around, you know, try to show itself. The small things, it's not going to harm anyone. Some people it could be scary, some people just, you know, brush it off.
Okay.
And then, even the Ghostbusters, when they come tonight,
okay,
we'll set it out and see what they get. I think we won't tell them anything. We'll just maybe put this and that photograph and maybe the wife, those three together or something.
Okay.
Yet again, the story found us. Items were placed, the group was exposed to them, and the story of the hanging of Nathaniel Bates unfolded.
I don't want to sit by this. What is this?
It looks like an axe.
The gentleman, was name was Nathaniel Bates.
He was probably bringing a little money in, but I would guess not a lot. Since Nathaniel had come here, he was staying in the house, but Kitty made sure she was never alone with him.
Fleeing an abusive marriage, Kitty took her two children from Illinois to Hagerstown, where she moved in with her mother and brother, and was happy for a time, until her brother tipped Nathaniel off to her whereabouts.
He had gotten a job with a farmer outside of town, within walking distance, but his job was to grub out the stubble in a field. That meant he would have a hoe and an axe and whatever he needed to cut up those roots.
The axe handle.
Implement of murder.
I don't like this. Like all the spit just dropped in my mouth.
No, it's the very first thing I went to because I thought I'm going to get the worst over first.
You can pull that down here if you like.
A little after noon, he came back into town because he'd broken his axe. And so he dropped it off at the blacksmith shop. And according to some of the witnesses who testified later, he sharpened his knife while he was at the blacksmith shop.
Okay, we're asking if anyone that's with us would come forward and please speak with us. The time is now 8:25.
Well, he also had a pail, which they assumed he was headed for the saloon, so he was known for drinking quite a bit, so that was their assumption. Well, he went on to the house. Now, whether he thought he would find her or maybe just went to get something to eat, we don't know, but he found Kitty there alone.
Now, there's the kitty.
We have the murder weapon, the axe handle. There's some of the blood there.
So again, if anyone is here with us, we'd like you to come forward and speak with us on recording here. Please tell us your name.
So he began to pester her about being his wife again, and she rejected him, and this is according to his testimony. And he became very angry. We don't know if he'd been drinking or not, but he became very angry. And he hit her with that broken axe handle, knocked her down. But he saw he hadn't killed her.
What were the names of your children?
Jemmies.
There's a lot of violent energy here. I mean, it's like really violent.
So he took his knife and cut her across the throat, and of course she died pretty quickly.
Whoever is with us, we ask you not to be frightened, but to come forward and communicate with us. Are you somehow related to one of these articles here? Mr. Bates, why did you murder your wife?
What he did was he killed his wife, used an axe handle, and then ended up slitting her throat too. He blamed it a lot on alcohol and family troubles.
Marx talks about living with his wife and his two daughters, and they were all very happy and all that, but they moved the mother-in-law in with them, and from then on, the family didn't get along.
You know, he had been abusive to her before, and a lot of times that kind of physical spousal abuse will accelerate until it becomes a murder.
There's another story here beside what we know.
So after that, he chose to walk a couple of blocks up here to Main Street, and there were pumps along Main Street, two or three of them, where you could get a drink, where you could wash off. And so he came to a pump and he cleaned himself off some. So then he walked on up here to, I think it was the barber shop, where was probably the hangout for some of the town loafers. And that's where he found Thomas Murray, the town marshal. And he said, I've just killed my wife.
Do we have any Toms in the story?
Well, immediately the town found out about it and they wanted to lynch him.
There's another angle to it all. Yeah, there's like another story. And
kind of a story within a story.
Yeah.
That's the way I would describe it.
Yeah. Were there two deaths?
There were spiritualists, there were groups of spiritualists at the time. It wasn't taken very seriously because there were a lot of churches also. But there were definitely people who believed in it and practiced it.
Kitty was not very well known in the town at that time. She was regarded as someone who was just, you know, had come to town and she lived a quiet life with her mother. But immediately she became a heroine. There was such sorrow because there were two little girls and they were pretty young children. So people felt sadness for the children. There was a company, I believe in Newcastle, that gave a coffin for her and they gave one for Bates. Well, in order to make some money for those children, they brought it up here. This was the public hall. This particular room was built for public events. And so this was the public place where they brought her body and viewed it.
I'm feeling a lot of energy over here. You know, I'm not a psychic, but I'm a little sensitive, and I'm feeling a lot of energy over in this area, so.
She was laid out right in here, and I'm sure that that was done because, but it was right here, you can see these steps, and there was no bar here. And she was on the floor, and then there were small things that they set the top of the casket on. Yeah.
was a public viewing. And then she was buried then in the afternoon out at the cemetery. May the 5th was when the trial began. Only took the jury a couple hours to bring in a verdict of hanging.
These are the actual shackles that he had on when he was hung.
The sheriff stepped up, making everything secure. The rope was placed around his neck, the knot coming just below the left ear. When this was completed, turnkey Murray placed the black cap over the doomed man's head, the cloth hiding the face from the crowd. Bates said in a loud voice, "Goodbye to all you dear friends. God bless you all."
Back in those days, people that were attending hangings were invited. And these are 135 invitations to come to the hanging. The execution of Nathaniel Bates, Richmond, Indiana, August 26, 1886. I believe they were just passed out. I've gone through the list. There's several doctors in there. There's five or six newspaper reporters. So it was all just people that I guess would be interested in attending a hanging.
There was my poor wife, and she was good and kind.
The priests bowed their heads, and sheriff stepped back and placed his hand upon the lever, and with one quick jerk, sprung the trap, which then fell with a crash. And the body of Nathaniel Bates shot downward 5 feet, the jerk breaking his neck. When the body shot downward, it whirled rapidly 5 times entirely around.
He was the last one that was hung in a county jail.
When the person was executed, they didn't die easily for some reason. It was not good.
There was a quivering of the limbs and a trembling of the body that further startled the horrified audience. At 12:23, the body fell, and the record of the pulsations taken by Dr. Hibbard were as follows. 1 minute, 76 beats. Second minute, 132 beats. Third minute, 129 beats. Fourth minute, 126. 5th, 124. 6th, 110. 7th, 102. 8th, 36. And scarcely to be recognized, 9 minutes 38. 9.5 minutes, no longer perceptible.
Mr. Bates, why did you murder your wife?
Michael's had 5 exorcisms, but that was to stop him from being choked, slapped, scratched, because sometimes something negative will come in, because spirits attract spirits. Something would come in, attack him, and then we would have to seek help to get rid of it. And then he would be fine for a while again.
I remember how it felt when I was younger. We'd always have people come over, and they would just seem to not really know what they're doing, didn't know how to help me, didn't know what to say to me, didn't know how to explain what I was going through. And just the feeling of not knowing what's going on and feeling helpless with the things that were going on, that's what makes me want to help people.
We started doing a lot of TV. Went through the Associated Press. It was so publicized, and on one show, Michael had said that he saw dead people. A lot of people figured it out, yes. We started having everybody come to the house after that. And that's how he became the boy of the Sixth Sense.
Michael is drawn to a room in the basement.
I saw the figure of a little girl in here. When he walked, right when he was walking out, we were standing behind him.
Can you tell me if you see one?
Yeah.
Probably because you're playing with a doll.
Maybe that's why the doll's here.
Energy over here, but it's not really into the form of a figure, so it's definitely a spirit in here, but I couldn't really tell you exactly what it is, but I'm going to assume it's probably still the same girl.
Why would they stay here? I mean, that's what I don't quite understand.
Maybe they just don't want to let go. I mean, all the belongings, everything in here has just stayed the same for so many years that maybe just doesn't want to leave and leave it unwatched. Make sure, you know, certain things aren't being changed.
Orbs are commonly thought to be spirit manifestations. Is this glowing ball of light the spirit of a lost little girl? Following his connection with the basement spirit, Michael studies a portrait that he believes resembles the girl he saw.
Well, that's Aunt Ruby, who mother didn't even know because she died before my mother was born. She was my mother's sister. It's been saved. She died about 1906 or 7, I think.
Mom just got touched.
She can't touch again?
Yeah. Well, maybe she's connected to these clothes. And the only thing left of her on this earth I have here.
It takes a lot of energy for a spirit to show itself in full form. It takes a lot less energy to show as an orb. But because of the fact that it takes a lot of energy to show itself, it's only going to show itself to you for a reason. I've had spirits show me how they were killed and, you know, details like that.
That's what it looks like to us, but does it look like that to you?
When I seen those, it was definitely the orbs. When I seen the full figure and I tried to take pictures of it, the camera just kept flashing and would not take the picture.
To witness that firsthand freedom.
What a real active place. It's crazy.
I guess I see it as a gift, but I don't really know how it is to live without it. And I don't feel too much different from anyone else because I'm so used to it, I'd feel normal as anyone else. But I think it was definitely given to me for a reason, and I definitely want to help people.
Frank's Box, a controversial electronic device that utilizes radio waves for spirits to communicate with the living.
Your name is...
So August 2nd, Fort Whispers Estates, Mitchell, Indiana.
925.
Is a little girl here with us?
The little girl's here. Did you hear that? Mm-hmm. You heard it through here.
Mm-hmm.
Rachel, do you miss your mom? Rachel?
Your name is...
My name is Mike. What's your name?
Basically, it's a radio that I altered to continually sweep the bands. And the idea is that the spirits can use the radio waves, much like they do ambient noise.
Can you tell us your name? I mean, we don't consider it ultimate evidence. I mean, because some of that stuff we have to be very skeptical about as far as what we get on it. But sometimes I've heard some things with this that just cannot be as easily explained.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know? Yeah, so we have to be skeptical of it, and that's part of it. This is still kind of experimental phase.
Yeah,
as
I'm
far
not sure
as,
how I feel about it.
Yeah, I'm still making judgments about it. It's, I mean, our minds are wide open to accept whatever comes across, and we are open to believe that whatever happens is a ghost, but in a lot of cases it can be explained as just something that's on the radio.
Rachel, if you're here with us, could you show yourself to us?
Can you give us a sign that you're here?
There's a lot of people that they say they're interested in it, but they don't really have the courage to stay a full night in a haunted house.
I never told anybody this, but about 2 weeks before he left, he called our house, absolutely flipping out. Very emotional, bawling, I don't know what's going on, can you guys make it over? That was the last time we spoke to him. He said, I've got to get out of here. Strangest thing we ever heard from him, and that was it.
Jared Marshall was the owner. And he had contacted the group because he had a lot of activity going on with him and his sister.
You do EMF. Michelle, why don't you take temp readings, and I'll take your eye on.
Be careful going down there.
It was so raspy, loud, and it was just horrendous. People were like curling up into balls down here.
Well, it's been a while since I've been out here, but it's like a ghost town when you drive in, and maybe you see like one or two cars, and that's it, or maybe one person walking.
1916 yearbook for Mitchell High School.
Dr. John A. Gibbons lived and ran his medical practice from this house. He had an adopted daughter named Rachel, who died in the home. It is said Rachel was terribly burned in a fire in the sitting room at Christmas time. Taken upstairs to her room, she languished and eventually died from her injuries.
They were hearing voices. Things were moving in the house.
Somebody asks a question of an entity and asks them to respond. And we hear a noise that doesn't sound like a regular person saying something back. The full sound went for about a minute, minute and a half. Is that in the house? And that's usually what happens before things start to happen.
This clip is taken in July in 2007.
The average is in the 0.8 to 0.9 range.
There was about seven of us here in the house.
Quite a shift down here though. It went from 1.5 and then up to 1.7.
So we had cameras set up upstairs in the hallway facing the servant's bedroom.
That far corner by the closet.
I'll figure it all out. I may have to sort through all this, and that's kind of how my psychic ability works. I've got different pieces of the puzzle.
I'm getting different readings in here now though.
Yeah, that corner is where we had a lot of activity in that room.
And also a camera sitting on the inside of the doorway, looking into the bedroom.
It was just a change, which was unusual. We're usually looking for a change in negative polarity, negative air ion change. I don't know that there's anything paranormal that's going on, but it was unusual that the readings kind of changed in here a little bit.
And what's interesting is that the dust started to sort of kick up. The place does not have central air.
The fact that he was a doctor and there was a operating room and there were probably blood and guts and all kinds of horrific things that happened here in that arena back there. But it's more than that.
You know, this is a heating vent that was sitting on the floor, but of course, July, it wasn't on. Mm-hmm. So there was nothing that would have caused any kind of movement that would kick up that much dust.
Well, I know I heard footsteps upstairs.
Do you feel her in here?
Michael, can you see her? I heard you in there.
On one hand, there was kindness, there was love, there were good things here. But I also keep, the whole time I've been in the house, I didn't realize it till now, I felt like I was walking on eggshells.
It sounded like there was something coming, but I kept hearing something back here.
Coming towards us?
We were talking to someone who was sitting on the couch, facing the monitor, saw something move across. just sort of like a flash of light.
She's very fascinated by all of the technology. She's feeling... She likes us being here. She likes us being here. What she likes is that we're trying to bring her comfort.
Good time in this house is going to be between 10:15 and 10:45.
This is Rachel's room.
For some reason, both times we were here, those were the hot times.
Whenever I did review it, I had put it into slow motion, and not only did it show up on camera four, very close to the camera, it also showed up underneath the doorway in the hallway view.
And she wants people to know that she's not trapped here, she's in the light. And the tunnel that we were picking up on, she comes and goes.
The dust started to sort of kick up just about 5 or 6 seconds before something had gone across. What else is interesting is that you see this figure, it looks like it takes a step, it looks like footsteps, boom, boom.
She's multi-dimensional, my words. So she's here, she can be many different places. She's in the light, but she also loves this place. This was her safe haven.
Where the doctor used to have his operating room, from what I understand. Jared would get woken up with the bed shaking and that type of activity in that room. People were getting grabbed when they looked up in the attic and that type of thing.
There was, in those days, it would have been called insanity.
I'm not going in there alone.
Okay, that's what I thought.
What did you say?
So I'm not going in there alone.
I'll go with you.
I was orphaned, taken in, and orphaned again. That's really weird. Something that was not right. She was trapped in her body because she looks very sick. And she looks very languishing. But that putrid, I can smell that putrid. And I feel, I'm back with the opiates again. They definitely gave her something for pain, because I feel like I'm in an opiated state.
You're saying that's an anomaly or something?
It's hard to tell.
Yeah.
I don't know. Could be.
Everybody's worried. She was so frail, or she was so sick. She was like overcome. She's overcome.
We might want to just kind of hang around there and do some EVP or something and see if we get something.
But I'm almost convinced of it now as I've gone through the house and gone through the different experiences. And actually, at one point, I felt like I had to get out of the house.
Let's go downstairs and we'll check that room out in here. I don't think that this is far as you've made it through the house so far, right?
Okay. Cool? Everybody cool? I can't see anything. Am I heading to the...
Yeah, you're heading.
We're honoring her space, and that's what she likes. Because she's the gatekeeper.
We were just talking about whether or not there was a disappointment room upstairs.
Okay.
And,
So when we feel her here, It's not because she's trapped because she died here. It's because she is this place and she is the gatekeeper, but she's in other places. I was orphaned, taken in, and orphaned again.
Whoa.
That's really weird.
If there's anyone with us now, we would like to communicate with you. My name is Mike. Can you please tell us your name?
Do we have someone else with us? Did you ever feel that? But maybe if we acknowledge them like we did, we're going to get, you know, more back from them. Maybe they might even communicate with us.
To me, what I was hearing seemed like they were intrigued by whatever was going on in here and kind of inching their way closer.
Yeah,
but
I keep hearing like somebody's walking around. Yep.
And it's been going on for probably like a couple of minutes.
Michelle, look down the hall. Straight down. Like, move over here and look down. Did you see what I saw? Okay, you saw what I was seeing.
I just saw it.
Okay. I wanted to have some confirmation on that.
What are you seeing?
A child.
Mm-hmm.
I see a child walking.
Yeah, isn't that cool? I was hoping you were going to see it. I'm getting goosebumps.
I do. Come a little bit closer.
Very cool. Thank you so much for showing us yourself. What's your name? I can tell you're kind of shy. You don't have to be scared to talk to either one of us. Oh my goodness. You are so sweet to come and visit us.
I like your pretty white dress.
It's beautiful. Oh, you're getting closer and closer. I can feel it. Oh no, stay with us. Stay with us.
That was just the bed creaking. That was just somebody moving. It's okay.
It's all right.
Do you want to come play?
Do we have someone else with us? Is there something that you wanted to tell us? Or were you just curious about what we were doing?
You can come closer to me.
Is there somebody else here?
She's still singing.
It's very faint.
Is she still there?
The spirit of Rachel is said to lurk in the shadows of Whisper's estates, hardly ever revealing herself, perhaps in fear of a more sinister force from the past.
Okay. That was one of the coolest things I have ever seen.
Light face, and I couldn't get a lot of features out of her face, but she definitely had a white dress, and I just saw her at first peek out, and then while I was looking at the same time Shannon was, I saw her full body on.
I don't see anyone. She just peeked out.
And she looked like she was just creeping towards us then, slowly after that, and then I think there was some noise, I think the bed creaked or something, and it scared her, and she took off behind the wall. And then she would kind of come in and out from the wall. And after that, you know, we went to kind of check it out, and I tried to go closer to her. I think I scared her as I tried to get closer to her, and she took off and was gone after that. I also tried to do some singing to try and comfort her and get her to come out a little bit more, and I think that I actually heard her singing with my ears very faintly, just a slight, almost whisper voice, very, very faint, very shy, very like unsure, almost a tremoring kind of voice. And I believe that everyone else heard it too, so I'm hoping that we get it on our recorders and on video.
I was seeing what I thought I was seeing, and when she saw the same thing, that made it even more incredible. I haven't seen anything like that since I was a 6-year-old child when I saw my grandfather. So, I mean, that was just an experience for me. And I think Michelle was even talking about the same thing.
I had not seen anything like that since I was a little girl, and I actually saw my grandmother for several years when I was a child, starting from the time I was about 4 or 5 till about 9 or 10. And that was the first time I've seen anything since. Just the feeling that I got all over my body, just the goosebumps and the power that I felt going through my body when I'm seeing this. It was really amazing and hard to describe.
And you kind of feel like if you move even like an inch, it's gonna go poof, and it'll be over, and you don't want it to be over.
That's true. I was actually holding my breath, thinking if I don't, I was afraid to make a sound. Mm-hmm. Because she just seemed so afraid of us, or I don't know what she was so afraid of, just so unsure of being near us. Maybe she sees so many people in here, she doesn't know what to do.
I was too far into the bedroom. I couldn't see down the hall where the girls were actually seeing the image. I did hear the same thing they described, the faint whispering, the voice of like a little girl, very faintly, and you catch a word or two here or there, but not like the whole thing. After it was gone and we went down the hall to investigate, as they walked into the alcove, I immediately felt I needed to go to the left near the stairway, and that there was something behind the closet door.
Come on, I'm going in there alone.
Okay, that's what I thought.
What did you say?
So I'm not going in there alone.
I'll go with you.
I called Renee over. She felt that it was in the corner. We backed something in the corner.
I felt like there was this wonderful, and then all of a sudden I felt like something else was here that was very, like, scary.
And we started to turn around and leave. I noticed something in the back corner down the other side on that same alcove where the little girl had been.
Authoritarian energy that could kind of turn on a dime and kind of pounce.
And as I walked back there to get some readings, I felt really strongly like there was somebody there. Was real happy with the fact that I was there, and I called Renee over, and I felt it go about the same time that she commented that she saw it go, and it actually went around on the other side of the wall. I do think I got an EMF meter reading back in that corner, but I kind of got distracted when it all started happening, and but I did get a reading back there.
I first attributed the detachment to the fact that, well, it was probably just too horrific for the adopted mother and father to pay attention to, but I think there was more to it. I get a feeling of, well, she's not perfect anymore, or she's damaged in some way. Like, they wanted this show.
Voices of the past, to me, are the true storytellers, unmasking now what was buried by time.
So I brought it home here. The longer the piano was, I'd see things. You couldn't see anything. You see something, like when I'm sitting here at night, something goes by. You know, you don't know what it is. And they'll come through here, just shooting through. They pull jigs on me. It's got ghosts with it. It's got ghosts with it. I want to get it out of here. You know, so I didn't think nothing about that, hell. I didn't believe in COVID.